Today, the webinar is on brut IPA yeast and single hop interaction. It's actually the second part of yeast and hop interactions. I decided to include some slides on the New England IPA because this webinar we did, I think, in May, so quite some time ago. But before I start, again, let me just do a very short introduction on where we are. We are based in Lille, or in the Lille area, actually, and the mother company, Le Saffre, and we are a business unit of Le Saffre. You are all here in this beautiful country. Lille is a very nice city, so if you ever have the opportunity to visit, please do. Now, obviously, you cannot travel. This is a It's classified now, at least in Holland, as an orange zone, and maybe it will become red in the future because of the corona crisis. That's why we have now these online webinars, which is well, quite a nice alternative for actual personal encounters. Although I prefer to do this in person, but anyway. Second picture on this slide is from our factory, and in one of the early webinars I discussed this. It's based in Ghent, and all our brewing yeasts are produced at this site. It's very close to Lille, only about like say 40-minute drive. So Fermentis is the business unit in Le Saffre that works for the world of fermented beverages. So we work for any beverage that is somewhat alcoholic, can be high or low. And we mainly focus obviously on beer, but we also do wine, cider, spirits, and any other drinkable alcohol beverages. Today we'll be obviously on yeast again. I think next week we'll discuss bacteria, and the week after we'll do spring blanche, I think, but let me stick to the subject here. So what about yeast? As I already mentioned this a few times, yeast is a sexual organism. It's small, it belongs to the fungal clade. It's not that far genetically from animals and plants, actually. It's a eukaryote, so we as humans share quite a lot of similar features. That's why yeasts are actually used a lot in health studies as model organisms for human cells. In nature, there are about 200,000 species. This is an estimate, can be more, could easily be 300,000, we don't know. But industrially, so the strains that are actually on the market, it's only a few hundred. So this is only a very small portion of the available natural diversity. That said, most yeasts that are present in nature are not really suitable for production of beer or any other food stuff. So for beer, we have two main species, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, the ale yeast, and Saccharomyces postrianus, the lager yeast. I already explained the differences, so I'll continue. At Fermentis now, we have 15 dry yeasts in our portfolio, 3 lagers and 12 ale yeasts. Today, I will discuss this one in detail, DA16, but I will also show results from other yeasts. Next to yeast, we have bacteria, Saf Sour LP652. I think the next webinar is on this one. We have some functional products, Spring Blanche, for instance, which is a yeast protein extract that you can use to create and maintain permanent haze in beer. So I will also do a webinar on this. And then we have fermentation aids, so basically yeast nutrients in the case where you have, for instance, a malt bill that is for instance, too low in nitrogen or any other minerals. So what do all these yeasts have in common? I just showed, well, they do alcoholic fermentation. I showed it this before. So alcoholic fermentation is presented here in this chemical reaction. It's very simplified. Bottom line is glucose is converted into two molecules of CO2 and two molecules of ethanol. And if you look at that by weight, it's about 1-to-1 ratio. You're mashing, so you know all the enzymes present in the barley will do its work and create fermentable sugars. A typical composition of a mash is shown here. So about 70% of fermentable sugars. The others are unfermentable, and this is a bit depending on the yeast strain, obviously. These can bring body to the beer. So sometimes it's desired, sometimes it is not. Today, in the part of Brut IPA, we don't want any residual sugar. So it will be zero. But I will show that later. So if we ferment these fermentable sugars, we produce, as I just showed, the majority is ethanol and CO2. So if you look at it percentage-wise, this is the main two products. But we also produce glycerol. Sometimes some acids are produced, acetic acid, citric acid, succinic acid. So typical acids that are present in the citric acid cycle. We also produce some biomass. On average, this is about 5% of all the sugars that you put in goes into biomass. And we produce aromas. And aromas, I've been discussing aromas quite a lot, because this is what discriminates the yeasts, because all yeasts make different aromas. As shown here, I also showed this slide before. So besides the normal production to ethanol, you also produce a lot of nice flavors that are actually the soul or the character of your beer. Two flavors I'd like to point out today is isoamyl acetate and ethyl acetate. These two compounds are produced by all the yeasts. So if you take an ale or a lager yeast, they produce these compounds, but obviously in different quantities. Genetically, if you look at the genetic background of our yeast, you can make a so-called phylogenetic tree from that. And it basically visualizes the distance, the genetic distance between our yeast. So to give you an example, yeast soft ale F2, the yeast for bottle re-fermentation, is very far away from, for instance, SO4. So these two yeasts have a to what's available in literature. We discovered actually that our current portfolio has quite a broad spectrum. So we cover basically everything and or everything. It's a lot, I would say. And the moment that we introduce a new strain on the market, it's because we are not covering some parts of the spectrum. For instance, here we have some empty space, here we have some empty space. So these could be interesting yeast also for brewing. But even though in the present portfolio, I'm quite convinced that practically all beers that you want to brew can be produced with our current range. As I showed before, if you change fermentation conditions, you change flavor profile. So even with the same genetic background, you can steer the fermentation to reach the desired flavors in your beer. So is genetic diversity flavor diversity? For some, yes. For others, no. If you think back on the W3470, I showed a few webinars ago on the different conditions, you saw I didn't move. While, for instance, the BE256, the Abbey style yeast, moved around a lot if you change conditions. To bring some sense and some guidance in the flavoring options of the yeast, we came up with quite a simple representation of flavors. So three axes: neutral, fruity, and spicy. And we did fermentations all under the same conditions. So 15 Plato wort, a bitterness of 25 IBU. We did this with ISO alpha extract, so no hops addition. We pitched all of them at 50 gram per hectoliter, and all the fermentations were done at 23 degrees at atmospheric pressure. And then if you position, you know, if you do the sensory analysis on the outcome of all these beers, then you can position the yeast according to their sensory characteristics. And that gives you this this visual interpretation. So if you don't, for your brew, I should say, then this is a good starting point. So if you, for instance, want to make a very fruity beer, you go along the fruity axis, and you could start with any of these to make a fruity beer. If you want to make a more spicy beer, go on this side. And if you want to make a more neutral beer, go on this axis. And this is just a starting point because, you know, as I showed a few webinars ago, if you change conditions, also these yeasts move around also on this slide. But as a starting point, it's a good start. So as I just mentioned, what's the yeast is an important actor in flavor formation, and we just had a webinar on the impact of fermentation conditions and also on ingredients, actually, the New England IPA, but I will repeat that part now. So what happens if you change the ingredients? You're actually looking at, in this case, a yeast and hop interaction. So if you have hops and these, if you are changing all of them, it will become a little bit of a mess, because hops by itself is already quite complex. So if you want to find out if there's any interaction between yeast and hops, we have to simplify. That's why we decided to keep the fermentation conditions the same for all the experiments I will show from now onwards, and just look at hops. And for the hops, we looked at different things, obviously volatiles, and most important, sensory analysis. I think, you know, during the course of this webinar cycle, you noticed that for us, a sensory analysis is the most important. What are we looking at next to, you know, normal fermentation parameters, normal fermentation measurements and analytics and aromas? We also do sensory, but also in this case we look at hop components specifically. For yeast and in fermentation, mainly the monoterpene alcohols from hops can have quite a dominant impact. So linalool, geraniol, the hoppy flavor, flowery flavor that you get from hops, is something that we look at. I'm not going to discuss all these complex compounds. That's more something for a hops expert. But at least we measured it, and then it will come back in our sensory analysis results. So first, case number one, New England IPA or hazy IPA. I will repeat quickly. So I just found some examples on the market that are out there. You see, they look a bit similar, but sometimes also different. Some have a very dense foam, some have no foam, and are a little bit opaque, not really hazy. Some are extremely hazy, some are a bit less hazy. So if we want to find the yeast for this style, we normally start with looking at the specific flavor descriptors on any of the style guides. So I show two of them here. And what is for the New England IPA a bit interesting is the style descriptor juicy. What's a juicy beer? So it is an official style descriptor. So starting from that, we came up with these parameters as most important descriptors. So juicy is actually the sensory equivalent of like a ripe, overripe fruit juice. It tastes a little bit like that. That's at least our perception. Well, hazy, you all know pale color. I will not go into all the details and explain later, you know, some of this, because I already did this and I don't want to repeat too much. So what we did, one type of New England IPA recipe, three hop varieties and nine types of yeast. These were the yeast that we studied in this part of the research. We used the 16 Plato Worth, consisting 10% flaked oaks, 10% flaked wheat, 80% Pilsner malt. We did quite a traditional mashing scheme, 40 minutes at 63, 25 minutes at 72, 1 minute mash off at 78. And then we dosed 1 kilogram per hectoliter hops. This is quite a normal amount, or an average amount, I would say, for New England IPA. Maybe it's a little bit a lot, to my personal opinion, but I've seen also values of 2 kilo per hectoliter. So there was research presented, I think, a few years ago already by the group of Tom Schellhammer, who found out that there's a maximum limit to, you know, what is useful in dry hopping dose. By heart, I think it was around 3.5 kilo per hectoliter. Above that, you are not extracting additional material from the hops. So we dosed these are in amounts one-third of each, and the dosing regime was as follows. We dosed 25% in the whirlpool, 25% after 2 days of fermentation, 25% after 4 days of fermentation, and 25% in maturation. Fermentation was done at 23 degrees. So let's go to a typical result. This is the only result I will show in detail, because as I mentioned, I already did this. So a typical sensory characteristic that is important for New England IPA is a turbidity level. So if you see here the selection of the beers, you immediately see that some of them, just by eye, you see that some of them are not really suitable for New England type. This looks more like a lager style or a Kölsch, similar here. And these are look a bit already more hazy. So if you put that on the sensory level chart, you can already indicate that, okay, in this case, K97, SO4 and S33, apparently create the most haze, so these could be very suitable for New England IPA. So we didn't only look at turbidity, obviously, we looked at many characters, and these are shown here on this spider plot. So to be clear, the brewing was the same for all the yeast. The fermentation conditions were the same. The only difference was actually the yeast. So that is shown here in this quite complex spider plot. Take home message here, there are a lot of differences. If you look at the thing I just mentioned, turbidity level, the one that is on the high end is, for instance, S33 here, SO4, K97, hop character. K97 is scores highest. Hop tropical, S33 scores highest in this experiment, etc. Things you don't like phenolic flavors, fermentation in this is beer style is not desired. So if you look at which yeast is this, this is the 134. It's a saison yeast, so it's POF positive. It produces this clovey notes. And if you don't want that in the beer and you don't want it in the New England IPA style, then this is not the best yeast to start from. So if we do a more statistical analysis on this data and make a so-called clustering of the data, this is called principal component analysis. So basically you visualize the data in another way. The red variables shown here are so the typical flavor descriptors or sensory parameters are shown in red. They are the active variables, and then the blue ones in this case are the yeast, are the observed are the observations that we did, and we position them in the same dimension. So by doing that, you can see that if what is important for New England IPA, it's the juicy part, hop tropical, turbidity, hop citric, and then you can see which yeasts are close to these descriptors. And from that, we see, okay, these four yeasts seem to be the best if you, you know, consider all data together. As mentioned, we also did analytical measurements, so volatiles. And if you put that here, so all these hop volatiles, hop components, it's shown in this PCA, you again see that if you remove it, just for clarity, that three yeasts are closest to basically pushing out most hop-forward flavors. If you look, just for your information, at the level of total hop oils, you see that, for instance, S33, K97 are quite high in hop oils, also SO4, T58. What I want to mention here is that there's a lot of differences. So the dosing is the same, the brewing is the same, there's just differences in yeast. So this means, or at least for us, it was an indication that some yeasts actually do more or are able to enhance the typical hop character that you find in beer. But I will discuss this in more detail later. So based on these results, we came up with this three yeasts as recommendations for brewing a New England IPA. Then the second case, Brut IPA or Champagne IPA or Cava IPA, whatever you want to call it, is a new style. It's a new beer style. So there are also new sensory attributes. Some style guides already included, but very limited. What we know is that a Brut IPA should be dry, so very low or no residual sugars. Carbonation should be high, and it should be very aromatic. So a lot of fruity and fruit-forward hop aromas are expected. It should look a little bit like this visually. Could be a bit darker, maybe, I don't know, but it should look a bit like a champagne. And if you think about the December month, where it is Christmas and when there's New Year, and if you want to brew something sparkling, this could be a nice alternative actually for champagne. So To find out, what yeast we need for this, first to produce it, we looked at what are the objectives. Well, we want to have a dry beer, so we said, okay, we need an apparent degree of fermentation, and we want to have a fast fermentation. We want to have high ABV, non-diastatic as yeast. We want to have a fruity flavor expression. And we want some enhancement of hoppy flavors, and like always, we don't want off flavors. And the solution that we figured out was, okay, let's start with a POF negative Saccharomyces cerevisiae and add an enzyme to that, amyloglucosidase. In this case, we use the amyloglucosidase from Aspergillus niger, which is also a fungus. So what is amyloglucosidase doing? It's an enzyme actually that cleaves large sugars, so dextrins, but even starch on two positions, the alpha 1,6 position and the alpha 1,4 position. So it's cut here. So you end up with only glucose molecules. And as you know, all or almost all yeast can ferment, all brewing yeast at least can ferment glucose. So in terms of experiments, what we did again, we came up with one Brut IPA reference recipe, and we used six yeast enzyme mixes. We used one say negative control, so a positive yeast that would, you know, would be beyond the style. We used three hop varieties again, and then did checked fermentation performance. We checked volatiles again and did sensory analysis. So the mixes that we studied are shown here. The wort is 14 Plato. We used 85% Pilsen malt. We added some sugar in advance to make sure to have a bone dry beer in the end. We did a traditional mash scheme, 63 degrees for 40 minutes, 72 degrees for 25 minutes, and mash off 1 minute at 78. We added 1/3 of each hop, so 1/3 Cascade, 1/3 Mosaic, 1/3 Citra, as a total of 700 gram per hectoliter. And in this case, we added it in the whirlpool, so no dry hopping. Fermentations were all done at 24 degrees, maturation at 0 degrees for 2 weeks. So we reached a final ABV of around 6.57%. We re-fermented everything with Safale F2 to end up with a carbonation level of 7 gram per liter, which is fairly high, but you know, some Belgian triples are even higher, so, or strong blondes, you can go up to 8 or maybe even 9 gram per liter. Because, you know, if you think about the style, if your beer is bone dry, if you don't have any residual sugar, if you don't have body, you also will have some issues with a foam layer. But for this style, it doesn't matter. So if you have high carbonation, the foam is normally not a big issue. So let's look at the fermentation and sugar profile. Here on the graph on the left, you see the days of fermentation and the degrees of Plato. So you see it's going down from say around 13 to 2 to 0 or even below 0 in 2 days. We have one somewhat slower one that took 5 days to come down. If you look at the final residual sugar in the beer, so if here is the wort is shown and the different sugars in the wort, so glucose, maltose, maltotriose, and then the higher sugars and dextrins, as you can see, all of them have no or a very low amount of residual sugar. So the amyloglucosidase did its work even at 24 degrees, because normally if you look up the activity of amyloglucosidase, it's higher at somewhat higher temperature, but also at lower temperature, this enzyme will still work. Then sensory analysis shown here. So this is an opened spider plot. So again, the fermentation conditions were the same for all the yeasts. And you see, I just want to point out some typical, I think it's on the next slide, some typical features. So if you look, for instance, at odor fruity character, so you look on the guys that are on the high side, this is a yellowish, so this is the DA16, very low in off flavor in both cases, so no sulfury character, again the DA16. If you look at hop tropical, we find mix 4 and again DA16. So overall, DA16 seems to have the best flavor profile. If we look at the hop volatiles, you know, analytically, you see that there are differences in the total sum of hop alcohols. So they are all on the high side, If you look at the sum of hop esters and terpenes, you see it a little. So this is an enlargement of what is shown here. You see that there are a little bit more differences. So for instance, between mix 3 and DA16, but DA16 is on the high side. Also our control, so the POF positive yeast, HA18, is also on the high side, but the others were all lower. So if we do a clustering analysis again and put all of the parameters that we have in this representation, we see the position of the different mixes. And obviously, as expected, the DA16 came out as best option. So it showed a high degree of fermentation, but all of them did. It was a part of the four mix that were fast. The 16% ABV, we don't know. We only went up to 7. Very good flavor, fruity flavor expression. Very good enhancement of the typical hop flavors like linalool or carophyllene. No off flavors. So the only thing that is remaining now is the high alcohol. And for that, we did some follow-up experiments. And this is very recent data. So we compared the DA16 again with the control HA18. We rehydrated it at 30 degrees for 30 minutes. And then we compared it to the yeast, which is present in the DA16 mix. And we pitched that directly in the wort. Pitching rates were 50 gram per hectoliter of yeast. So in case of DA16, we pitched 100 gram per liter per hectoliter, because the DA16 ratio to AMG, so the yeast AMG ratio, is 1:1 by weight. So in all conditions, we pitched the same amount of yeast. We used two gravities, 20 and 25 Plato, and did fermentations at 25 degrees. We did it in shake flasks. And for some reason, they shaked it, because it's just simply on a machine at 100 RPM. If we look at fermentation kinetics, so here on the x-axis, you have the time. On the y-axis, you have the ethanol concentration. So if you look at the yeast only, you see here the kinetics at 20 Plato, 25 Plato. So this is obvious. And then if you add the amyloglucosidase, which means that you have more fermentable sugars, you increase. And this one went up to, say, 15, around 15%. So this really shows the impact of the amyloglucosidase. And also interesting is that the kinetics of both the DA16 and the HA18 are very similar in both conditions. Obviously not the flavor profile, but then volatiles, which were measured at the end of fermentation. So this is the yeast by itself. This is the mix. And this is the control, the HA18. And as you can see, if you look at higher alcohols or esters at two different Platos, in all cases, and the DA16 appeared to be the most aromatic. So this confirmed actually also the results at higher wort gravities. This part of the research is not done. We are still working on this, but to get more data. But at this moment, DA16 was already made available based on these results. So this is just to sum up DA16. This is like a marketing slide, guys. Sorry for that. It's ideal for dry, flavorful beers. High in total esters, high in higher alcohols, very high apparent attenuation. Sedimentation is medium, but if you're a little bit patient, and the yeast will settle, and you can produce a very bright champagne-style beer. So far, also in the third webinar, and also just now, we looked at yeast and multiple hops interactions, And if you think about that, hops is already quite complex by itself. So we figured it would be a good idea to also start working and doing some research on what about yeast and a single hop? What can we learn from that? Because then in the previous examples I showed, we were always using three hop varieties in the experiments. And the reason is that we know the market, we check the market, and we just use what many brewers are using to have some kind of comparable situation. So we can assist and you best with our experiments. But academically, it makes things far more complex. So we decided to start looking at yeast and single hop.
Dino, we have a question.
Yeah.
Sorry for interrupting you, but
no
question. Could you use the DA16 under pressure or pressurized fermentation?
Yes, I don't see why.
Okay,
not.
Will it be any difference in flavor?
I don't know that. To be honest, I'm looking into the literature on for you guys on pressurized or counter pressure fermentations, and there is not much available, to be honest. And what I've learned so far is that what you do is mainly reduce the development of flavors. So you basically, temper the whole fermentation a bit more. So you make it more neutral. In this case, the DA16 is so aromatic. It's an aromatic bomb, I would say. So even if you pressurize it, it will still be very aromatic. I just don't see the point of pressurizing in this case, because you want to have more aromatics in your beer in this style.
Yeah, I hope Stefan is satisfied with that answer. But the short reply is yes.
Okay, good.
But why?
Okay. So because of the lack of knowledge in yeast and hop interaction, and also the potential of our yeasts in late hop additions and in dry hopping, we decided to go for Cascade as a first study of yeast and a single hop interaction. Why Cascade? Well, it's still the most popular American hop. It has quite a nice flavor profile. It's used in many IPAs still. So many, typical IPA flavors are coming from Cascade or children from Cascade or derived varieties from Cascade. But this is actually, the mother of many varieties. So we thought it would be a good starting point. So what we did is, again, experiments, all the same fermentations with in total 11 yeasts, 3 lagers and 7 ales, of which 3 PoV positive. And what we did is we changed the hopping regime. So in the first set of experiments, we only did late hopping. So this means we added the hops to the whirlpool. And we did that at the beginning, as you can read here. So the pumping of the liquid took about 10 minutes, and then about 15 minutes of settling. So the total contact time about 25 minutes at 90 degrees. For dry hopping, we did that after 24 hours of fermentation. So actually at end of day one, which is quite early. To be honest, but if you want to find interaction between yeast and hop, you have to make sure that there's plenty of interaction possibility. So you have to give them the yeast and some time to interact. So we did late hopping, we did dry hopping. For those, you all know, but dry hopping is that when you put the hops in the fermenter. And we did also a combination of late hopping and dry hopping. So in amounts, 50-50. So 50% in the whirlpool, 50% in the fermenter. And then again, we looked at fermentation performance, volatiles, and did sensory analysis. So what came out, I'm going to skip a lot of slides and go immediately to the clustering, is a picture like this. So here you have, the active variables, so bitterness, herbal, hoppy, floral, that's the typical flavor descriptors. And then the observed variables around that. And these are all the yeasts in the different regimes. So to give you an idea, US05 late dry hopping is here. US05 dry hopping is here. US05 late hopping is here. So if you look at it, the yeast spread out all over the place just by changing the hopping regime. So to make a little bit more sense of the soup, I will highlight some. So two of the yeasts I discussed before were W3470 and the BE256. So we already saw that if you change pitching rate, gravity, or temperature, that you can actually control or steer more or less the fermentation flavor produced by 256. In addition to that, if you change the hopping regime, you can also get very different flavor profiles in the beer. So late hopping is very distant from dry hopping, is very distant from late and dry hopping. So in the case of late dry hopping, you would get more herbal notes. In the case of dry hopping, you get more general hoppiness. In the case of late hopping, you don't find much hop character at all, which is quite interesting. So it gives you as a brewer even more opportunities to produce new flavors. That said, if you look at W3470, as we found out before, whatever you do in fermentation conditions, at least in the conditions that we tested, this yeast didn't move. It and now if you look at it in different hopping regimes, they are very close together. So this yeast is very interesting because it also remains very neutral in different hopping regimes.
And a new question here as well. Would the interaction differ much between, say, green hops or pellet hops?
Oh,
A tough one.
Tough one. So first of all, green hops in my knowledge is hops that is not dried, and you compare that to pellet hops, which is obviously dried and pelletized, there's always some difference. So I think that's a bit hard to compare. But if you compare a normal dry hop, so hop cones, with pellets, what I understood from my nice colleagues at Charles Farm is that the normal flavor development is not different if you use cones or if you use pellets. For the case of green hops, there is difference. I know every year at the harvest, a lot of brewers go to get green hops immediately after harvest, and they use it in an undried form. I never had the pleasure to drink any of those green hopped beers. Because if I understand well, you have to drink those quite rapidly because the hoppiness goes down a little bit more rapidly in those green hopped beers. But I don't have the personal experience. So in terms of interaction, I don't know. Sorry for that, Daniel.
I think he's typing another question or maybe some additional. Sometimes take a while before you can see the
Okay.
Wait. Yeah.
Yes.
It seems that he's satisfied with that reply.
thank you, Daniel. Yeah, these studies were done with pellets, indeed, with the T90 pellets. So, what is interesting in this data set is obviously the yeast that move around and. Gabriella, our head of sensory, decided to call these the gypsies, And because they move around in the results. If you take, for instance, the S189 lager yeast, if you only do a late hopping, you find that it's like herbal bitter. If you do late dry hopping, you don't find this character back. If you do dry hopping only, you find a very strong general fruitiness and hoppiness. So these are very distant. So three completely different beers. For K97, we find something very similar. So three very different beers. For S33 also, three very different beers. All on the fruity side, but still different. So if you bring all data together in a 2D fashion, so in this representation, it's again a spider plot, but the observed variables are now, instead of the parameters, are now on the outside. So, and the yeast strains are here on the outside, and then the areas represent the flavor descriptor. So this is just, I will not go into detail, but this is just for you to see that these three hopping regimes result in three completely different images. So in late hopping, the general hoppy aroma is not as strong as in dry hopping. You can see that immediately. In dry hopping, you also see that fruitiness is quite significant, and more significant than in late hopping, and also or maybe comparable, I would say, to late and dry hopping. So this is just for you to realize that the hopping regime really has an impact on the flavor of the beer. But now, so the key learnings from this part are that a different hopping regime will affect the hop flavor perception, obviously. And for every hopping regime, each specific yeast will deliver a specific flavor profile. And as we saw, in association with Cascade, the three gypsies appear to be the most interesting. They show the most diversity in the data set. But there's obviously a but. But what would be the impact of fermentation flavors produced by the yeast on the overall hop fruity perception? So because we found that except the S189, but as I already showed, S33 and K97 are quite fruity yeasts. So we were thinking, does that help in overall hop fruity perception in the beer? So thinking about that, we decided, okay, we have to introduce a blank, an experiment without any hops added later in the process. So there was some bitter hops added, but there was not no late hopping, also no dry hopping. And we did experiments with late hopping and dry hopping together to have a result. And I will show those impacts now. So this is a combination of all yeast. I will go into more detail, don't worry, because this is a very complex picture. Again, all the typical flavor descriptors in the unhopped and hop situation. And as you can see, this is quite narrow. All the lines are close together, and here it's more spread out. And for instance, if you look at general hoppy expression, here it's nearly zero. Here you have a line that stands out. So to make a little bit more sense out of this data, we opened actually this spider plot. So you can simply open it and put it in a 2D fashion to a better visualization actually of the results. Then if you look, for instance, at Fruity Global as flavor descriptor in the unhop situations versus the hop situation, you see an increase for a strong increase for some yeast and a mild increase for others. So the strong increase in this case indicated K97 a little bit as expected, but also T58. If you look at general hoppy expression, it's again K97, a US05, S33. If you look at hop tropical, it's again K97, S33, etc. So to even simplify this a bit more, I will just discriminate between lagers, the POF positive yeasts, and so the phenolic yeast and the POF negative yeast. And so based on what you saw, you can conclude that the yeast can change the hop flavor perception. But let's look at that a little bit more closely. So for the lagers, again, if we compare the unhopped and the hopped situation, you see here fruity, the global fruity expression. You see that it's a lot higher. So there's a strong push in fruity aroma if you hop the beer. Then if you look at the whole general hoppy notes, so the typical, the herbal, floral, citric, overall, this is quite low. And if you hop the beer, this is very high. So there's a clear indication, you know, that the contributes to the overall flavor perception in the beer. Also in the case of lagers, and the one that is the strongest actually is the S189 that also came out in the PCA analysis. So, you know, if you consider making a hoppy lager, you might want to try S189 because this will push out the hop flavors the most. Then the POF positive yeasts. As you can see, there is some impact. So if you look at the global fruitiness again, it goes up, but not as much as you would think or as you would expect. Similar for the general hoppy expression, it goes up, obviously, if you hop. So this is lucky because, you know, if you have a POF positive yeast, it's very dominant. And this dominance is shown here. So these are the yeast, the three yeasts that produce these phenolic off flavors, the clovey notes. And as you can see, it's if you have an unhopped situation, it's high, but also in the hopped situation is high. And actually, what we found is that this very strong phenolic flavor note is actually masking a little bit the hoppy perception, so the hoppy notes. So if you want to make a very hoppy saison, it's quite hard to have this really these hoppy notes in the beer. Then the POF negative ones, the 256, K97, SO4, S33, and US05. In the unhopped and the hopped situation, again, if you look at the fruity, the global fruitiness, obviously it goes up. And the strongest, as I already indicated, is K97. If you look at the general hop aroma descriptors, they also go up, but you know, in different to different extents. K97 is in most cases the highest, not always. The floral part is more more pushed by an indication that there's more going on than just hopping, and because all the yeast, the fermentation were all done under the same conditions, so different yeast, different interaction. So if we cluster this data, again, to the main flavor descriptors, we see two sides. So on the left side, we find all our unhopped beers back. And on the right side, we find all the hopped beer back. which is nice. And so actually the data makes sense, and also the clustering makes sense. If you look a bit more closely, we also see that the yeast that produce phenolics also are all on the same side of the clustering. So they are all on the upper side, all towards this phenolic clovey parameter, which is nice. So if we compare, so I'm just taking this one and looking at now comparing blank, unhopped, and hopped. If you look at in the unhopped situation, you see that K97, S189, and S33, you know, just as fermentation-wise, make the most fruitiness. They produce the most floral notes, and that's why they cluster here, which is interesting. So the question is that also the case in the hopped situation? And as you could expect, it's also the case in the hopped situation. So actually, what we see is that if you have very fruity fermentation flavors, so a lot of fruitiness by the yeast, then also the fruity perception of the hop flavors is also improved, is also better. So there's some kind of synergy. So if this is strong, the fermentation flavors are strong in fruitiness, also the hoppiness increases and the fruity perception. Then if we take out this phenolic parameter to simplify the data and actually to get an even better visualization. So if you take this out, you find this graph. So it's again hopped, but then without the POF vector, as we call it. Then you see all these descriptors, hop tropical, fruity, general hoppiness, banana. And you see again the three yeasts clustered here. To discriminate between them, you see that there is some difference between the three because they deliver different fruity notes. And I summarize that here. So if you take the situation where you look at cascade and yeast interaction, if you want to have more tropical notes in the beer and herbal notes, then K97 is the best option. If you want to have more herbal floral notes, then S189, which is a lager, it's very interesting. And then more on the fruity side, as we already saw before, also in the New England IPA, banana, citrus, then S33 shows, you know, the best interaction with cascade. So final conclusions for New England IPA, S33, K97, and SO4 are the best options. For Brut IPA, in our experiments, the DA16 came out as most aromatic yeast. And then in the yeast cascade studies, I showed that different hopping regime affects the hop flavor perception. So even in the same fermentation conditions, you see that hopping regime and different yeasts also change the hop flavor perception. So for every regime, the yeast will deliver a specific profile. Some stay neutral, as we saw with W3470. Others are the gypsies, S33, K97, and S189, and change the hop flavor perception if you change the hopping regime. Actually, these last three also show the most push of hop-forward flavors. And this indicates a synergy between the yeast and the hop-derived flavor compounds, which is quite cool. This research is very new, so it's still ongoing. And as soon as we know more, we will obviously disseminate the research with you again. I got a question from others asking, will you also look at yeast and malt interactions? Maybe in the future, but as you can understand, there are many different hop varieties, but also many different malt varieties. In malt, It's basically an unlimited amount of options that you can look at. So in I think it will take some time, but it's something that we will consider doing to also get more of an idea on, okay, how is the yeast working with different types of malt. And with that, I'm almost at the end. I just like to point out our Fermentis app again, and where we have a lot of data available. You can download it for free. Next one will be on kettle souring with Seth Sauer. I think it's next week, right, Jonas? Next week.
Correct.
And last but not least,
I'm sorry.
You know, if you are have the time, it would be great if you could, leave your comments and suggestions again in our forum, because we will use it also to create a new future webinars. That's the end of it.
I mentioned that if you want to see this webinar afterwards, you will get an email, and we will collect them also a link on our website. I posted in the chat the address to our website. You will also find all earlier webinars gathered there, so if you want to see them afterwards, except for the NAPA webinar, because we had some technical issue there, unfortunately. But all the others are collected there if you want to see it afterwards, or you can see all of them in a row maybe.
Yes, and yeah, that could be. And in addition to that, I try to do some automation on this EDU-DIP platform, and if all is working, I'm not sure yet, but you should get an email automatically tomorrow, also with the link to the recording of the webinar. If it's not working, I will hear it next week.
I already had taken a couple of days, I think, but maybe the process is speeded up a bit now when we have done it a couple of times. I'm not sure.
Okay, yeah.
But they will get the link afterwards.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any more questions, guys? You're welcome, Jonas.
Thank you. There you have a question.
Yes. I have hard to get lower FG on S33, yes. S33 is one that leaves quite a lot of residual sugars behind. So if you want to get a lower final gravity, S33 is not the best option. As I showed, if you use AMG, you can go to bone dry beers. You can go to zero or even below zero. If you just look at it from a yeast perspective, what you can do is adapt your mashing scheme a little bit to get more maltose and glucose in your mash and in your wort in the end. That's the most easy, I would say. If it's not going lower, then you could consider using another yeast like the BE256. Which has a higher attenuation and will leave less residual sugar. But I think, Jasper, it's if it's just based on what you say, your final gravity is 1030, 1022, I have to know more to help you out better. I need to know your original gravity. I need to know how you pitched. I need to know the composition of your. So I think it's better that you send me an email so I can assist you better.
Okay, he says.
Yeah, because it will not be relevant for the rest of the people.
No, I see.
More questions, guys?
Doesn't seem so.
No. Okay. Well, then, thanks very much for joining again.
Now I'm getting some questions.
Thanks. Okay. Thanks, Patrick. I hope to see you next week.
Yeah, you're more than welcome. Same time, same website. No, not the same website. It's another address.
<indeed. laughs>
I shouldn't say that.
It's on the screen. Okay. Have
Thanks
a great weekend. Bye.
Yeah, same to you. Bye-bye.